in welcoming Yang Berbahagia Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin bin Syed Mohamed Tahir. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me utmost pleasure now to invite our keynote speaker, Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin bin Syed Mohamed Tahir, Executive Chairman of CMS Consortium Eco Tour Sendirian Berhad, to deliver his keynote address.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu syafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Saudara pengacara majlis yang saya muliakan, Profesor Dr. Pozah binti Mama Isa, Faculty of Administrative Science and Policy Studies UITM, fellow lecturers, students, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh, and a very good afternoon. Thank you MC for not giving me any time at all to rest. Sorry, my apologies, I came kind of late. Drove directly from KL. I do apologize for changing a little bit of the program. I was supposed to speak to you this morning, I believe, but I had to ask for rescheduling to speak to you this afternoon. Now, just to do a little bit of housekeeping, I was made to understand most of you, if not all of you, are from the School of Administrative Science and Policy Studies. And I was made to understand by your battery today. A lot of you are aspiring to be company secretaries. Is that a correct assumption? Yes? How many of you here doesn't want to? The reason why I asked, I think I'm supposed to give a talk about corporate employability, and I think it's very perhaps taking the short time of about an hour to a bit more focus about company secretary. So if the audience allow me, I will speak more in general a little bit, and more specific to the role and expectation of a company secretary. Now, I've been meeting a lot of graduates, students from many universities, you know, over the last few years. And often enough, the topic is always, how do I get and how do I secure a good job, you know, when I graduate? I have a son who just graduated, and his question is also the same. How do we get employment? And now, no matter what you do, no matter how much you are being prepared to face the reality of the corporate world, and the reality is the choice and the final decision is really up to you. You will have to make the difference. You will have to decide and make all the necessary preparation before you start your journey. I would like to perhaps do this in three segments. If I assume that you are about to graduate, perhaps, you know, this year or maybe next year, the several phases that you have to go through. As always, the most critical part, I mean, the first step is always to prepare a resume. You are lucky, you are born in the year or in time of the digital media. All you have to do is go to the website, write resume, and I think you have thousands of resumes that you can follow. Not during my time, we had to go and beg for samples of resume before we can make a presentable one. But in preparing a resume, there are just two points that I'd like to highlight. I'm not an expert, but I've seen many resumes during my lifetime, reading them and understanding them. But can you imagine, you're going to write a resume, and presumably enough, when you go and write to university, well, you have to be assured that you're not the only resume that's come to the table. The first person that probably read your resume is either the HR manager or the head of HR. And if you imagine, if you are the HR manager of the head of HR, there are thousands of resumes that comes towards you. You need to pick one that is most attractive and the one that gets your attention. So for that, you have to allow your imagination to go a little bit wild. I mean, what is going to make the resume to be attractive to be picked up as a first? That's the first step. Secondly, of course, about reading the resume, I think there are two things that you need to stress on. I've seen people that highlight in all the academic background, and some has put as early as the primary school, or even as in preschool. You don't have to go to that detail. I think what's important is to know that you have come from an established institution. What happens in your secondary school? I mean, you can make a general notation, but you don't have to go into detail. So apart from your academic, your family background, which is very important to give the audience a feel about who you are and your background. But what's more important, and presumably all of you do not have experience, so you don't have a work experience for you to talk about, is about what is it that you aspire. And this is you and the audience. And you have to translate, and I always like to believe, do not copy the words from another person. It must come from your heart. There are two things that would happen if you copy from another person. Ciplak daripada resume orang lain, you put very nice beautiful words. Come the real date of interview, the interviewer, you ask, what do you mean by this statement that you make? And you are stuck, because that doesn't come from your heart. It doesn't really reflect you, the person. So what's more important is to put you, the person, in simple, doesn't have to be high English, Oxford English and dictionary words, but easy for people to understand. Because my philosophy in life, it is you that is going to make the difference, not the people that you that is around you. So it's very important for you to translate in your resume, your aspirations, what is it that you can contribute. And the worst thing that an interviewer wants to find out is the difference between what's on paper and the reality. Kalau baca resume, you are impressed. But once the interview, orang kata indah khabar dari rupa kan. I mean, it's a totally disconnect between the real individual and the person that you see on the resume. That is the most fatal mistake that you can make. So my advice to you is, as you go browse to the internet to look at all the interviews that you can see, please be aware. Please be wary that please try to use your own words in trying to do a resume. The rest, the format, I leave it to you. Some have colorful papers. It's all fine. But do not overdo it. Make it simple, yet professional, and the choice of words, font is also very important. So that's one part, and I'm sure all of you are, already perhaps have started and preparing a resume. Now, the more difficult and the more important is the interview themselves. I have this, assumption that I make always, when I look at a resume and before the interviewer come in, I can see whether they are from a local university and whether they are from a foreign university. Generally, the interviewer already have this preset mind about who you are even before you walk into the room. Your objective is to create what we call the right perception. And typically, kalau interviewer ni, always very high expectation from a foreign university graduate as compared to a local university. And generally, sorry to say, that's normally is the case. Performance of people from a foreign university is much higher as compared to graduates from a local university. That's a reality. But the gaps are getting closer and closer by the day. And perhaps that's a good sign. But generally, that's what the trend. Now, when you come to an interview, I'm sure you heard about the saying, first impression is the most important. Yeah? First impression is not when you open the door, it's as you enter the building. So a lot of people spend a lot of time preparing the resume, but do not spend a lot of time in dressing yourself up properly for the interview. I mean, this is the most important aspect of your career, and do spend some time. When I say spending time, it's not spending money to buy nice, beautiful clothes. You can still wear the same clothes that you have as long as they are presentable and they are neat. I mean, do not overkill themselves. I mean, do not overkill yourself and trying to have nice, trendy, branded name. That is not going to impress the interviewer at all. So dressing becomes very important. I've seen many who dress very well, and I've seen who dress... Kita nak interview pun tak ada selega, kan? You just don't have the appetite. The presentation is just awkward. Particularly today, that's what, there are many people who want to try to secure a job. So your presentation and dressing is very, very important. Number two, obviously, you have to bring all your documentations and certificates. I think it's very important. And do not cheat. I have hired someone before and didn't realize that he cheated on his certificate. A few years after being in the company, some whistleblower, you know, I mean, I suppose orang yang berdengki, people perhaps jealous of him, dig up into his past and find out that his resume or his certificate was fake. It came into the system and obviously he was fired on the spot. So whatever you do, it's always good to be truthful, you know, and do not mind to amplify or overstate your achievement because people will do check. When you leave, if someone were to wanted to hire you, the right SOP is to do a reference check. And normally they will make a reference check. And the last thing they don't want to know is you are not telling the truth. So whatever the case may be, you are what you are. And people say, what you see is what you get. So it's always good to present the truth. So one of the things that I really noticed, and I like to emphasize this a little bit in an interview, is about confidence. You must be seen, I mean, people say, oozing out with confidence. You know, I mean, as you walk into the room, the level of confidence in terms of your eye contact, into the way you walk, the way you greet, the way you sit, and the way you interact in the question and answer must be the one with full of confidence. I have seen many, when you speak, the last thing you want to do is not to have eye contact. Kalau kalau bertanya, you'll be looking down and looking. Some people, somehow or other, I don't know, by default or by their own habitual thing, they just don't like to see people in the eye. I don't understand. I have taught, and I've went to school, when you want to talk to people, you must look in the eye. Kan? I mean, kerana ni orang, selalunya orang Melayu lah, orang Melayu ni malu sikit. Kan? Kerana malu tak terkena tempat. You must, I mean, when you look at the eye, don't look like staring. I mean, look and have a proper conversation. Because the audience want to see whether your eye contact is good. Because that's what communication is all about. Secondly, when you are given a question, answer it properly and answer it what we call direct to the question. Orang tanya lain, jawabnya lain. That's also very wrong. And normally people were shy to ask and assume that that's a question, but you know, and the interpretation was wrong. So if you have any doubt, it's always good to say, can I see clarity in what you mean in the question? And that perhaps, I think, is also very important. So answer direct to the point and do not go beyond. Kadang-kadang kita terbawa kan, kita oversell. My philosophy always is, do not oversell yourself. When you set high expectations, I mean, interview kan, oh, saya semua boleh buat, I can do this, I can do that, I've done this. You over, I mean, who is it to check? But when actually someone gives you an assignment, then you fail miserably. And it's not acceptable. But you undersell, I mean, moderately, when you achieve, then that's a good thing and that's what good employees will look at. So it's very important to manage expectations in the interview. And I always, you know, I don't blame the candidates. Sometimes they are just too overzealous in trying to make a point and to explain the capability, and perhaps they are over ambitious in their explanation. I give you one example of one particular person, and this is about 7 years ago. Just to illustrate the point about confidence, I still remember this guy. It's a Chinese guy who comes from UNITA. He's an engineer. And typically when I interview an engineer in my previous job in Proton, we will ask, among all the other questions, towards the end, we will ask a question about what do you aspire to be and how do you vision yourself in the company for 5 to 10 years? A typical engineer, I mean, I'm an engineer by profession, by training, would say, I want to be the best chassis engineer, I want the best powertrain engineer in Proton the next 5 to 10 years. Some people will say, I want to be a good, you know, R&D scientist. And that's a typical question. But this particular Chinese guy, when I asked the question, he paused for a while. He looked at me. There was three of us, me, a head of R&D, and the head of HR. He looked at me, and I think it was only about 5 to 10 seconds. Then he answered, Dato' Sri, in the next 5 to 10 years, if you ask me, I want to be sitting in your position. And I hired the guy. Not because he was, I mean, one would say he's a bit cocky, kan? But I like his conviction on his ability and his clarity where he wants to go. Now, obviously, he's not going to be the MD in the next 5 years. That I know for a fact. But he was very clear. And the way he said it, the way he looked at me in the eyes, I mean, there was no hesitation at all. Bukan kata kelintong. The guy really believes that he can be, you know, someone in the next 5 to 10 years. So these are the body language that you have to, what we call, sharpen yourself. I don't know, Puan, whether this is class. I went to the university in the US. Typically, an engineering student will go to the physical, you know, the typical science classes, thermodynamics, you know, and so on and so forth. I went to this one particular class, and I still remember, and that class has a very big impact to me until today. It's what I call Psychology 101. It's Psych 01, and the name of the class is called A Study of Abnormal Human Behavior. I took it as an elective, so there's no exam. It's only pass or fail. I don't want to make my life complex. To tell you the truth, the only reason why I went to that class is because there were a lot of ladies in the class. Engineering classes, I mean, none of you are engineers, right? Engineering classes are dull, all men in the US. So I come from a kampung in Kota Baru. I go to US. I want to hang around among blondes. So the only way I could do this is go. I mean, that's the reality. But what is important is what I get out of the class, not because I did a few blondes, I wish I didn't. But that study of abnormal human behavior, the assignment that you took for that semester was only one. You are supposed to identify 5 subjects, human being, male or female, doesn't matter, black or white, 5 people, and you are supposed to follow this individual throughout the semester when you have the time. So I identified 5 individuals, a few people in my class and friends or people that I am familiar with, that I've seen them around. So the first part of the semester, you are supposed to follow, you know, when you have this time and you study the schedule of this individual, to follow them where they are, not from close, but from a bit of a distance. And you are supposed to observe how they behave. For example, people would go to the cafeteria during lunch and how they eat their, at that time, a Burger King, for example. Is it very nice, you know, nimble chewing of a bite of a burger, or they gobble up the burger for them? So, and you're supposed to see how they interact with their friends, how they walk. So I actually observed this 5 individuals, and I was supposed to make a conclusion. A conclusion about how they are in terms of their own personality. Introvert, extrovert, friendly, reserved, and so on. I mean, I can only assume. I do not know who these people are. They're supposed to be strangers. So I make my own assumptions. And I write a report after observing them for about 2.5 months. The last part of the semester is about giving them a set of questions. I think there were 50 questions that they were supposed to ask. It was all pre-designed. They were supposed to, you answer the question, it would then tell you the kind of character you are. I'm sure some of you might have gone to a 360 degrees, you know, analysis question. And I give them the question, I introduce myself, because I didn't tell them that I've been following them for the last 2.5 months. I would be in trouble. Then I was to compare. And that was my assignment. And out of the 5, I got 4 pretty much correct, and I got 1 almost the opposite. Now, 2 lessons that I've learned. Number 1, behavior of people and the way you teach, I mean, the way you talk, the way you interact, can really tell you about the person. I think that's very important. And that the same goes when you go into an interview. Your ability to communicate and your ability to connect. And it goes beyond just the interview. It's about your social interaction within your peers, your bosses, so on and so forth. Secondly, I always don't ever judge the book by the cover. The guy that I got wrong was a black guy. And this is 1981. the only perception of a black guy in Malaysia was the R&B, the Soul Train, you know, program that you see on TV. And normally they are just happy-go-lucky, you know. I mean, people who doesn't know, who are very indisciplined. So when I saw this black guy, when I follow him, my perception of him, I was loud, extrovert, aggressive. That's the perception that I have. But in reality, when a guy answers a question, apparently he's very timid and very reserved. So now, you know, it's a totally different perception that I've got of him. But that also taught me a lesson, you know. As much as I'd like to think I can interpret people, you always cannot really, you know, judge the book by the cover. You really have to understand. So back to my point about communication and being confident, I think doing the interview is very, very important for you to be able to connect. There'll probably be at least minimum two people to interview you. When you do address, look at them in the eye and don't be too stiff. Use hand language, you know, hand movements, move a little bit, make gestures. I've seen some who are just solid as a rock, and I mean, it's like you're a robot, and I mean, people do not want to hire a robot. People want to hire individuals and human beings that have feelings. Because in any company, the asset of the company is always about the human capital. And surely they are looking for more than just an academic. So, and the third thing that you want to do in an interview also is to do your homework. I get very agitated when people come to an interview in my company. Of course, dulu kat Proton lah. And even today in my publisher company, people do not do the background. When you ask, please tell us what you know about Proton. All they can say, oh, Proton, sell this and sell that, and names, you know. And sometimes even their quotations are wrong in terms of facts. While today, you have no more excuse. All you have to do is type in the internet, either you can go to the website, and you go to the annual report. If I'm an interviewer, I'd be very impressed, particularly if you aspire to be company secretary. Because company secretaries, in my view, are the gatekeeper of the board. I got three company secretaries in my public, everyone in my one of my public company, and one of them really excel. And as a chairman of the board, I really, really rely on her for everything about the progress of the meeting. Now, and she, even though she's only a company secretary, sometimes she knows more than just a CEO because she writes proper minutes. Not only she writes, she reads and she understands. So if you're coming for some company secretary, what do we expect for you to at least understand about the company, particularly if you are going to a public listed company. Sekarang pun kalau tak public listed company, can you go to SSM, you can already ask for the financial accounts, you can see. So everything, there's no more excuse for you to say, oh, I didn't do my homework, I was not prepared. And that doesn't give the interviewer an impression that you are serious and you are keen. If you just hear, I mean, see, in an interviewer, you judge the people by two. If this candidate is going to come and stay with my company for the next 5 to 10 years, or is this candidate coming to use my company as a jumping stone for the next career? If I size you up to be, you are only coming to my company because you have no other choice, you're only going to wait for about 1 year or 6 months, and then you're going off, I do not want to hire that kind of individual. Because every hiring is a process. Every new recruit costs the company money and time. And no company wants to have this high turnover in terms of recruitment. So you need to differentiate the kind of person you have. Sometimes people don't have a choice. Nak cari kerja yang ideal, tak ada, settle for the second best or the third best. And sometimes when you go open, your heart is not there in interview anyway. They just want to make the crowd. So all these things becomes very important when you go for the interview. So, I mean, I don't want to go into detail. I just want to go into the third part, which is more about company setting. So, takeaway point number two, apart from the resume, is doing the interview themselves. Please be prepared. And in the company secretary, I mean, there are a lot of good company secretaries out there. What makes you better than others? I was talking to your dean, Prof. Tadi, that I think UITM has some practical training program, which I really encourage. My only comment, I think 5 weeks is a bit too short. I think you need to do a little bit more. I think she was talking about preparing yourself by taking the opportunity to attend annual general meetings, AGM, I think that's good. And please select, Prof, don't go to the AGM that's very mild. Pick the hot and explosive AGM. Some AGMs can be very, very engaging. You have minority shareholders who really attack the board, and they put the board and always the company secretary, you know, in a very difficult. That's the kind of board AGM that you want to go and observe. So you are really understand this. Yamana, every motion pass, you know, approve. And that's dull, not exciting. Yeah, I think that's good. I also like to encourage you, apart from literature, is also to understand what does the Securities Commission does, particularly about Bursa. There are many requirements. SSM, for example, you know, the company's law. All these are very important. It must be at your fingertips. You see today, particularly when you are board of directors, the liability and the responsibility of board directors are very punitive. Gone were the days, you know, in the Companies Act that directors can get away. Today, if you are a public listed company, I mean, I take my responsibility very seriously. And sometimes I pay attention in the minutes that you write. You can go to jail if you approve the minutes that was wrong and you didn't make a comment. It's a minute that you approve and the company secretary didn't do her job properly, or because you abstained but it was recorded that you also approve and you didn't make any comment and the motion is passed and approved the minutes, there's no turning back. So that is why, you know, company secretary is important. Kadang-kadang company secretary pun jahat juga, kau tim, kan? Dengan chairman pun dia boleh kau tim, dengan board, dia company secretary who just make the minutes, you know, in the way they want it to be. Just because you protect certain individual. So I think the integrity of company secretary is very much. So I think it's good for you to expose. Understanding a little bit the dynamics about company secretary, the role and responsibilities before you go into interview. So that's the second segment. Now, I want to spend a bit more time about your role and the expectation of company secretary. Okay, I'm just trying to perhaps imagine yourself. Try to imagine yourself now a company secretary. You're entering a boardroom. Do you know where always normally does a company secretary sit? Tahu. Okay, good. Yes, the company secretary sits next to the chairman. Even the MD sometimes sit next to the chairman. So that, by virtue of that, tells you how important the company secretary is. The eyes and the ears of the chairman are the company secretary. Okay, let's run to the motion. Before a good practice, before any board meeting, the company secretary must approach and talk to two individuals. Number one, the MD of the company or the CEO of the company, to make sure that the papers are there, the agenda is proper. And once the MD agreed, the next person that you have to meet and you really have to be aligned is a chairman of the board. Chairman of any board doesn't like surprises in any board meeting. They are the chairman of the board. The board is the highest authority in the company, and chairman sometimes does the casting votes. So he wants to be on top. Particularly, you have a chairman who's a Tan Sri, who's very high senior ranking. He doesn't want to look silly in any board meeting. So it's your responsibility to size up and prepare the chairman. And a good company secretary prepares sometimes a script for the chairman. Bukan semua chairman yang baca board meeting, board minutes sebelum datang. Some chairman come just being ceremonial but want to look good. So you prepare the script. Kalau you prepare man tu, you'll be the chairman's best friend. I can guarantee you. So preparation before the board meeting becomes very important. And it is always the role of the company secretary to make sure that the proceedings of the board meetings are there by making sure that the papers are already, you know, in the being circulated, for example. If there's a presentation, the presentation is ready. I was in one public listed company before. The chairman of the board chased the management out because the slides were not ready. I mean, you might get a very difficult chairman. But then, I mean, I don't think it's the responsibility of the MD, but I think it was the responsibility of the company secretary to remind the management. So you need to follow what we call the likes and dislikes of the chairman. So preparing, making sure the slides are good, the attendance is there, and obviously you also should call the rest of the board, the directors, to know who's coming and who's not. So that's preparing the chairman of the board before he enters the room. You go to the room, you go to see him 5 or 10 minutes before, you brief him, he's happy, and you and him and the MD walks to the boardroom and you preside, and he presides over the board meeting. Now you are the company secretary, and the role of the company secretary are twofold. Often enough, people always say company secretary is only on kata, minutes saja. Kerja dia tunjuk, minutes. He doesn't even look at people. Look at his notepad and just take minutes. And obviously minutes, and you have this device that takes recording. And it's always good practice because sometimes you are too slow. I think that is wrong. A good company secretary not only writes, but listen to the proceedings of the board. My view is this. There are some important discussion. Obviously, the board papers are very detailed. Objective, background, assumption, analysis, then finally always a recommendation to the board. What is it at the board? You read it. You think everything will be already enough for you to make the minutes. And normally that becomes the skeleton of the minutes of the meeting. But often enough, in my experience, the deliberations of the board carry sometimes a different tangent to the board paper. And kalau you gali sangat, if you are just too fixative about the board paper, you tend to lose the content and the spirit of that discussion. Sometimes the board wants to see the spirit. Paper number one, the board is required to consider, that's what the company secretary writes, and no other deliberation, the board approves. Yes, the board finally approved, but many board members want to see the spirit being put into the minutes. What was the content of the deliberation? Not word by word. You wouldn't say the chairman said this, the board member says, not that. But the discussion must be captured, make simple, and to be embedded in the minutes. That becomes very important. 5 years down the line, someone were to extract the minute. Today, you go to the blog, the latest issue. Let's be real about it. 1 MDB, right? Everybody reads about all the minutes. And if you read, I know Tan Sri Baki very well, and you read the minutes of the meeting, they really describe what is the deliberation at the board. And now, 2009, 7 years down the line, 6 years, now people are using that minutes as a proof of the deliberation. Can you imagine that company secretary just write, the board is proof? Nobody can say I make a disclaimer. Nobody can say that I objected. Nobody can say that I cautioned the CEO. And that's why today board minutes becomes very important. So don't ever think you are only a company secretary. Aku macai saja mah, kan? Tak ada executive power, tukang tulis minute, not so important. Some people feel that way. But the reality is you are very important. If you write the right minutes, you might protect an individual. But of course, it must be always minutes that reflect the truth. So writing minutes becomes very important. And always just do not look at the notes and the papers, but really understand the content. So that's one that you have to make sure. Number two, if you are company secretary, and I know some people that are company secretaries to many companies, I cannot understand. As much as you think that you want to make money, you cannot be company secretary to so many companies. How do you juggle your time? Not only juggle your time, how do you understand the knowledge? A good company secretary, in my view, is not only the person that write the good minutes, but also understand the business. Simply because if you don't understand the business, how are you going to write a proper minute? Particularly in my industry before, the process of manufacturing a car. My company secretary, Naman Nizam, he can tell you about manufacturing a car. He's only a company secretary. He doesn't go to the factory, but he reads enough papers and, you know, and he listens carefully. And when he has the time, he goes out to R&D and understand the business. And that makes you a much more effective company secretary. Some chemistry, malas lah, buat apa. I'm just a company secretary. You know, I'm not responsible for the running of the company. Yes. If that's, you know, I mean, that's no denial. But I don't think you'll be an effective company secretary if you don't really understand the nature of the business. Because soon enough, you are supposed to, what we call, translate instruction and certain part of the business in the minutes. Number two. Number three, you must be what we call the policeman in the boardroom. Policeman ni bukan, you know, to reprimand people, but to remind the board about the do's and the don'ts. For example, the articles of association of the company will say that it must be by consensus or it must be by simple majority. Sometimes kita ni board members, yeah, we are just so used, semua okay kawan-kawan, or okay, we assume everything by consensus. Tapi one consenting or dissenting views is not been heard. He might say, no, I objected. Then people say, I know your objection. Then company secretary kata, it's resolved. Walhal, the MAA say it must be consensus. One dissenting director, which means the motion cannot be passed. So you have to be careful. So who advises the board? Chairman mesti tak ingat. MD pun kadang-kadang harapkan kami secretary. The board director lagi tak ingat. So in order to do that, the role of the company secretary becomes very severe. And I've seen many times, and I'm sure you see, you can look at many literatures, that the board gets into trouble because the company secretary doesn't remind. Even more acute if you are part of a public listed company. I mean, we rely on our company secretary to remind us, oh, ini kalau buat deliberation, once it's minuted in the board, tomorrow you must also release a statement to Bursa, for example, announcement. Company secretary yang tak, is not, you know, up to mark, doesn't remind the board, doesn't remind the management, a week after that, baru nak issue Bursa. By the time you issue to Bursa, your minutes is reflected that you only make a decision a week before, the Bursa can reprimand you. Because you only have a few days before, you know, that you have the responsibility to address it to Bursa. Particularly, we talk about critical issues like financial numbers, joint ventures, agreement that you enter. All this, siapa lagi tahu? It's a company secretary. So, the rules and regulation of the entity that you evolve with, whether you are Sendirian Berhad ke, whether you are Berhad ke, whatever industry, I mean, those are basically Bursa, SSM, Securities Commission, you know, the Companies Act, all this you have to understand, and not only understand, but it must be the tip of your, you know, of your fingertips. Because people do rely. And the worst scenario is, board member, kalau salah, kena bayar denda. And even more extreme, not only that we get paid not enough, but you can even go to jail, you know, as a board member. So being a board member is, and when I get invited to sit in a public listed company, I always look at the company secretary. Kalau company secretary yang cakap ni, kita rasa confident lah. Because we know that he or she will remind us and what our responsibility. And it's always easy to forget the responsibility of the company secretary. Now, the other thing about company secretary is about, you must be what we call equipped, you know, and friendly to technology. A lot of board meetings today are going away from board papers. I said one public listed company that board papers are secreted to the iPad. And you go into the boardroom, there's no papers at all. All the meetings and the papers are in the iPad. So as a board member, the only thing that I bring into the boardroom is an iPad. All the papers, assumption, presentations like, and the chairman of the board will go through and we write notations on the iPad. So kalau you tak technology savvy ni, kelang-kabut sikit lah. And it's always good for you to be on top of things and board members like, company secretary, who are very creative in, you know, putting slides, making presentation. That's very, very important. That's the role of a company secretary. That's normal, day-to-day, and normally a typical company, minimum you will probably have at least 4 board meetings in a year. Banks, I sit in one public listed company, this is a bank, we have board meetings every month. So you imagine the amount of work that that you have to churn out. And not only you sit as a company secretary at the main board, sometimes you have to sit as company secretary for a subsidiary board. Sometimes worse still, if you are company secretary, you have to sit in the account, you know, in the audit committee, where you have to start dealing with numbers. So as a company secretary, even though you are not trained as accountant, you also must understand numbers. Numbers ni ada day, ladies and gentlemen, if you put the wrong numbers, you will get yourself into a lot of trouble. So I think it's very also important for you to have knowledge about accounting. So that you're able to make sure that you reflect the financial statements very clearly. And if you are a listed company, you have to make disclosure, and the minutes must be very correct. So now, that will happen in the day-to-day preparation of a company secretary. Now, how then will you prepare yourself now to make yourself to that level of expectations? Whatever you learn today in UITM, I think those are the basic fundamentals. My suggestion to you is to perhaps live or get experience of sitting in one before you see the reality. AGM, it is very important. I hope, I wish, maybe some of you might get the opportunity to sit in one or two board meetings. I think it's very important to you understand. And I believe you Google, I was Googling coming here, you actually can see slides and videos of some of the board meetings. That might help you. Because you need to prepare yourself. Skills that you need, minute writing is very important. Language, bahasa and English. Some people, bahasa, they can master English, susah. And I can assure you, most of the minutes of meeting are in English. Now, I mean, I got 3 boys and 3, I mean, on my own. They speak reasonably good English, but writing is another thing altogether. So, company secretary, kena pandai lah. You have to be fluent in your writing. Translating, you know, an action or a discussion in words is not very easy. And as I said before, I have a chairman who's very critical about spelling. And I tell you, he will put down the secretary in front of everybody. Kata, apa lah ni spelling? And tak lulus English ke? Grammars are wrong. I mean, I also look, I'm a bit embarrassed. But he's a company secretary. He needs to buck up. We pay for his services. Especially if you are not in-house. There are 2 types of company secretaries. Eh? One is in-house, where the company pays for a secretary, and you do nothing else. So normally the expectations are high. But when you are an external company secretary, and people do this because, you know, I mean, company secretaries work only once in 4 months or 3 months, and people have a very high expectation, people pay for your service, and sometimes the service is very expensive. Then you get rubbish by coming in reports, you know. And not because you are not smart in your work, but your language is terrible. Sorry to say, lah. This is not, I think, something that I can teach you. I don't think UITM can even teach you. It's all about practice. And the faster, the more often you write, and grammatical mistakes, obviously people can excuse once in a while, it's, you know, you cannot be, you know, doing it all the time. So language, I think, is very important for you to prepare. Thirdly, company secretary is dressing. Dress ini kena canggih sikit lah. And the men, obviously, I mean, any boardroom, you come with a full suit, a tie. Ladies pun kena smartly dress. Because company secretaries really sometimes represent. Kalau kena duduk kat AGM, company secretary, sebelah chairman. Sebelah chairman berani, MD. And they only look at the 3 individual in the middle. Orang lain semua okey, kami sekretari selekeh pakai, kan? Malu lah. And so dressing is also very important. Your personality, I mean, maybe dressing might not be the right word, not be, it's your personality becomes very important. The way you conduct yourself, your grooming, it becomes very important, kan? Tapi kalau tak pandai bawa diri dalam kami, because you are basically presenting the company. And often enough, when you go for road shows, the company secretary is always present to make sure everything is on track. You know? It depends on. So those are the things that you can prepare yourself today, even before you enter into the workspace. Once you enter the workspace, the best is to learn from others. Do not think you get a degree from UITM, I'm the expert, I don't need anything else. I can assure you, knowledge is an ongoing process. As old as I am, and I've been to many companies and experienced that I am, I'm still on this learning mode. I learn every day. And particularly today, you know, I mean, where you have access to technology and information at your fingertips, you must always learn. So that's what you have to do when you are in the company. Secondly, what you have to do in the company, if you also have to have a very high level of discipline. Company secretary must be in the boardroom earliest. Cannot be the last to enter the boardroom. He must come to the boardroom 10 or 15 minutes before the board meeting, checking everything is sure, and he must be sitting there when the board directors come in. Kalau company secretary tak ada discipline, itu susah. So the team become very important in a company secretary. The third thing that you have to do is the art of communication. Now I want to explain a little bit about what I mean by communication. If I were to ask the audience here what the meaning of communication, I think most of you will raise your hand and say, the three communication is about the art of the ability to speak. That's not wrong, but I don't think that is complete. Communication is the art of communicating, talking, but it's also the ability to listen. So I'm sure you heard this proverb to say, seek first to understand before you be understood. So as a company secretary, you must really understand the dynamics of the board of directors. They are probably people of multiracial background, diverse background, prominent politicians maybe. So you must have this ability to connect and to communicate, not only to express yourself, but also to listen to what they are saying. That's one part of communication. The second part of communication, the one that I was telling you about, the experience that I had when I was in the university, is about the body language. I read this book in 1982, I believe. It's a book that's written by someone from Turkey by the name of Khalil Gibran. Now, in his book, and I still remember, he says, Khalil Gibran says in his book, if you want to understand someone better, you listen not to what he says, but you listen to what he does not say. Let me repeat. If you want to understand someone better, you listen not to what he says, but you listen to what he does not say. You understand? Apa cerita? Abang. So it again back to the art of communication. Communicating is not about just talking to someone. It's not only complete when you start listening to someone. It will only be complete if you understand beyond the language, which is the body language, what he says and what he does not say. Let me take a very simple example. I suppose most of you are not married yet. I mean, to those married people in front here, my wife for 24 years, I don't recall my wife ever telling me that she doesn't like this, she doesn't want me to talk about this, blah, 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 and so on. I don't think when I akad nikah dengan dia, her father, my late father-in-law ever says me, or my daughter doesn't like this. I don't think that's been spoken. But today, after living with her for 24 years, I know what she likes and I know what she doesn't like. I know what if I were to bring the subject, she will get very explosive. She get very upset. Just like her, she knows things that I don't like. Now, how did that happen? We don't communicate. And that's exactly what Khalil Gibran means. Khalil Gibran says, if you want to understand someone better, listen to know what he says, but listen to what he does not say. So sometimes when you interact, when you go into the boardroom, particularly the boardroom, and depends, some boardrooms are very mild, very boring, 5 minutes, I mean, board people is past, 2 hours, sumo dah selesai, some boardroom could be a day. Whatever environment that you are in, you must really understand the dynamics of the individuals in the boardroom. And a good practice, in my view, is always to go beyond what's been said. Understand the character and spend time. I have a very simple rule. Before I go to a board meeting, when I was in Proton, I will try to meet every board of directors. Not to buy their vote if you want to pass a paper, but I want to understand the dynamics of the board. And then when I present a paper, I can already make a guess what is their aspiration, what is their view. And it's always good to anticipate. You prepare yourself for the battle that you want to go. Because at the end of the day, you as a managing director of the company, you want to get your job done. And when you have a dissenting director, your job becomes very, very difficult. So, I mean, it's a continuous effort on management. But so similarly, a company secretary has to do that. Company secretary needs to write board, you know. And sometimes, you know, dissenting voice, you know, board papers, directors can be very difficult. You know, scream at your company secretary because you're not writing in good minutes. So you need to engage. Your job is not only to be a good company secretary, but to make sure that the life of the management, the MD, is easy. Because management have limit authority. Kalau company secretary salah aja tulis dalam board minute, if the management approve something contrary to board minute, even though what is spoken was different, then the management will get into trouble. I was reprimanded once because the company secretary wrote the wrong minutes. Nasib baik, the chairman remembered. Oh no, this is not what was approved. This was not what was agreed. There was a genuine mistake. There was no bad malice intended by the company secretary. But the other directors reprimanded me and said that I didn't have the authority to approve this. But the chairman remembered, at the conclusion of the deliberation, he said, I leave it to the managing director to approve. So it becomes very important. And don't have this imagination that you go to a board meeting where all the company directors semua ngamcing semua. Some are hostile. And sometimes you, as a company secretary, are stuck in the middle. Nan, orang nak suruh you tulis minute in favor of them as compared in favor of the others. So where do you hold your principles? And this is where you will be tested limit. So communication, I think, is also very important in being a good company secretary. The next one is about principle. I want to touch a little bit. I've seen a few company secretaries yang boleh dibeli. And see, the company secretaries in a normal company reports to the chairman in terms of direct line of report. But day to day, administratively, it reports to the board. I mean, to the managing director of the company. So siapa yang decide bonus, siapa yang decide increment of the company secretary? Yeah. So the managing director lah. So kadang-kadang nak bodi siapa? So you, I hope people, graduates of UITM, are people who are what we call with principle. So, ladies and gentlemen, I came here with three main objectives. I just want to recap before I end. Number one, if it's about corporate employability, the first stage is about preparing a resume. And nothing beats, you know, I think you are very lucky. You have access to many examples. Two things I remember, not the content, but an expression of how you are, number one. Number two is about how you go to the interview. I've seen many who have failed miserably, and I've seen some who are very outstanding. You are not one in a few, you are one in hundreds of people that are attending interview. What makes you different is the first time you enter the door into the interviewer, that makes the difference, and that will drive your interview. So prepare yourself to be addressed, understanding about the knowledge, look at people in the eye, and communicate in a way. Do not be a fake. Oh, interview, cakap kemain lagi. Bila buat kerja, langsung tak boleh buat. Jam. And I get very upset, you know, when I say, how come you interviewed, but ini semua, you know, tipu semua. That was the second. The third phase is in the workplace. As a company secretary, you please understand. The name second secretary, kadang-kadang nama tak glamour. Kan, kerja tulis minit. Kan, tak ada authority. Kan, tak ada orang yang report ke dia. So people, some people have this view, it's a very, I mean, a very, apa ni, non-glamorous job. But do not underestimate today particularly the importance of being a good company secretary. Companies rely on you to be effective. Managing director relies you to be truthful. The chairman relies you to remind him or her not to break the laws of the company. Company secretary yang best, everything goes smooth. Yang teruk, some people can get to jail, some people can be fined, some people can be reprimanded. So the lives of many people really also rely on you. So do not estimate your importance, you know, in any company. So I hope that, you know, kind of wrap up my, you know, short presentation. Is there okay? Let's go direct to Q&A. Any question? If I can be of assistance, as long as you're not looking for a job. No question. All crystal clear. Okay, well, if that's done, first of all, I'd like to thank UITM for inviting me. It's always been a pleasure to come, and I always enjoy engaging with university students, you know. I mean, for whatever 2 cents worth of experience that I have, if I can impart and help you and guide you to make better decisions in your life, I think that would be very good. I would like to thank you for being patient. I know after lunch is always a graveyard shift. People always tend to sleep and snooze, so I'm happy to see some of you are still awake. So I hope, you know, you enjoy the session, and I wish you all the best. And perhaps one day some of you might be a company secretary of one of my companies. If you do, just tell me, hey, listen, remember many years ago you were there in Surman to give us a talk. So thank you very much for coming, and I wish you all the best. Sekian, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Yang Berbahagia. And my sincere apology for the inconvenience just now.
I believe my partner and I were too eager to hear to your talk. Okay, so now we would like to invite the Dean of Faculty of Administrative Science and Policy Studies, Professor Dr. Fauzia binti Muhammad Isa, to present our token of appreciation to Yang Berbahagia, Datuk Sri Syed Zainal Abidin bin Syed Mohamed Tahir.